Medicinal cannabis users and supporters of it are descending on Parliament today to have their say on a potential law change. The bill would see those who are terminally ill and with a year left to live have a legal defence against prosecution for illicit marijuana use. Joining us now is criminal lawyer Tudor Clee. Good morning.
Good morning.
Is this bill going to go far enough? I mean, how many terminally ill patients are actually prosecuted for marijuana use?
Well, that's exactly what the issue is. Hayley, is I see this as rearranging deck chairs on the Titanic. The real problem in New Zealand at the moment is the uncertainty around who gets prosecuted for cannabis in the first place. 10 years ago, everyone who was caught with cannabis was prosecuted. Mm. At the moment, maybe 30% of people aren't even taken to court if they're found with cannabis. Of the ones who go to court, maybe 30% of those are effectively let off through the judicial process, and that leaves the last one-third who are actually in trouble. So that degree of uncertainty creates a lot of problem in cannabis law, and I see that this particular law, which is specifying people with 1 year left who are terminally ill, is simply exacerbating that problem of uncertainty.
So who is getting let off, and why is there uncertainty? Are police using de facto decriminalisation?
Yes, absolutely. So the level of pre-charge warnings, which is where the police officer makes a decision on the spot about whether to prosecute someone or not, has effectively gone from zero to 30 to 40% in the last 10 years.
Isn't that good? Isn't that a good thing?
Well, the problem is it's a good thing for the people who get let off scot-free, but if we have three people, one of them who gets let off on the side of the road, one who goes to court has legal costs, a risk of conviction, the possibility of losing their job or travel opportunities, but still gets let off, and then you have the third person who's the one effectively holding all the responsibility for everybody else. And it's simply not fair.
Do you think that this bill then needs to go further and move away just from medicinal cannabis into recreational use and look at decriminalising?
Well, that's really the issue. You have to say this. If someone is terminally ill, under this bill, they would not be allowed to grow their own cannabis. So they won't be able to have a plant there. Maybe that's what they prefer to do. The chances of a police officer walking in and finding someone with 1 or 2 months left to live, growing a plant, which is clearly illegal under the new bill, putting handcuffs on them and taking them to the police station, is zero. So if it's not going to happen, why are we complicating the law in the first place?
What is the point? That's so true. I mean, do you think yourself it needs to go further?
Well, in terms of a legal perspective, in terms of having a justice system which is clear and fair to everybody, we either need to have a system where everybody is prosecuted, so at least it's an even playing field, or nobody is.
What about, this access to it? Of course, as you say, if you're allowed to smoke it because you're terminally ill, but you can't grow it and you can't actually buy it anywhere, you're going to have to get access to it illegally as well.
Yeah, potentially, and that's again where the problem is that the person who goes and picks it up for you because you're too ill to go and collect it yourself, then they are risking prosecution.
Why are we so scared of cannabis in New Zealand? Or in society as a whole, really, globally?
That I definitely don't know the answer to.
Okay, sorry to put you on the spot there. So currently, how many people are actually prosecuted for cannabis use?
It's several thousand a year at the moment, so that's gone down from maybe 6,000 or 7,000 a year, I think, 10 years ago. And a lot of that is to do with the pre-charge warnings. Mm-hmm. But the people I tend to deal with in court on a day-to-day basis are more often than not men in their 50s or 60s who own their own properties, they have their own businesses, they've never had any involvement with the police in their life, and they enjoy smoking cannabis at home. And by the time they call me, they've usually been caught by accident. The police have come over to check something else or nothing to do with breaking any other law. And then they end up in court facing very serious sanctions for something that quite reasonably can be argued is a victimless crime that they're carrying out.
Well, they could victimless. Also, the harm that comes from cannabis is probably quite closely related and not even as bad as alcohol, which is obviously completely legal. I mean, it's crazy that we're criminalising these people, these men, as you say. Are there some people that we criminalise more than others?
I don't know about that necessarily. I mean, obviously the statistics about young people in particular being more at the attention of the police and whatnot. But the real issue that I see in terms of how we're criminalising people is that if you're cultivating the cannabis yourself, the police do not exercise that discretion to give you a pre-charge warning. So what it means is if you go to the local gang house and you buy the cannabis and it's sitting on your table, you have a one-third chance of not even going to court. if you decide to not support the local gang house and grow it yourself, there is a 100% chance that you're going to court. Right. And that's, again, just leading into this period of total uncertainty and anomalies.
It is. I mean, I think we need to be a bit more mature about this myself, actually. Thank you for your time this morning, Tudor Clee.
Thank you.